inordinate number of children that have been killed by gun violence this year. Since January 1st, 2020, until September 23rd, 937 children, infant to age 17, have died from gun violence. Most due to domestic violence and drive-by shootings. The youngest was 2 months old. On November 7th at 6 p.m., we are planning to hold an interdenominational candlelight vigil on the fields of St. Joseph's Church. We will read the name of each child and light a candle in their memory. But we need help. We need members of the parish to be hosts, to show our guests where to go on the grounds. We need people who would be willing to read the names and other people who would be willing to light the candles. We have sent letters to the other Catholic churches in the area and to some other Christian churches as well as temples in the Bradenton area. So we don't know how many people will be here in attendance. We know that St. Joseph's is always gracious and welcoming, and we hope that you will assist us to make this vigil a success. If you do plan to attend, please bring a mask and a small battery-powered flashlight or flashlight in your cell phone. I'll be at the back of the church after Mass if you're interested in helping. Thank you.
And we welcome you to St. Joseph Church on this, the 26th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our presider is Father Sean. And as we prepare for worship, we once again remind you to silence your cell phones, wear a mask, and observe social distancing. Some announcements, more announcements. We have printed worship aids, and they are available at the entrances of the church. You are welcome to take one, but you will need to take it home with you after Mass, since they can only be used one time. In addition, they are posted on our parish website, so you can use your smartphones and tablets during Mass if you prefer. The Adoration Chapel is open. Only those who are signed up to pray will be admitted. No walk-ins. To sign up, please see our parish website or call the church office. Registration is open also for households of faith religious education classes for children. In-person classes start on October 4th. For more information, go to the parish website or call the parish office. Heads up, next weekend there will be a second collection taken for Respect Life Sunday. Also next week, the lay Dominicans will be having a formation meeting Thursday, October 8th, in the O'Donnell Room at noon. Anyone interested in learning more about the lay Dominicans may call the parish office for more information. And for those of us who normally attend the 9 o'clock Mass, the St. Joseph Chorale will be returning to sing at Mass next Sunday, but with only 22 masked singers. We plan to build from there as the virus dictates. Please stand for our entrance hymn.
Brought here to you in the light of this day. Son throughout all of history, called to be light to the whole human race. Gather us in, the rich and the haughty, gather us in, the proud and the strong. Give us a heart so weak and so lowly, give us the courage to enter the song.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we begin, a quick announcement. We're using my cell phone to broadcast the Mass this morning because of some Wi-Fi difficulties. So for all those watching online, we won't have the normal camera back and forth, but thank you for praying and joining with us this morning. And so, brothers and sisters, we gather here on this 26th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Let's first acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you are mighty God and Prince of Peace. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you are Son of God and Son of Mary. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, lead us in our journey of faith. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May mighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life. Manifest your almighty power, above all by pardoning and showing mercy. Bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to obtain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. And we ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Thus says the Lord, You say, the Lord's way is not fair. Hear now, house of Israel. Is it my way that is unfair? Or rather, are not your ways unfair? When someone virtuous turns away from virtue to commit inequity and dies, it is because of the inequity he committed that he must die. But if he turns from the wickedness he has committed and does what is right and just, he shall preserve his life, since he has turned away from all the sins that he has committed. He shall surely live. He shall not die. The word of the Lord.
Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any solace in love, any participation in the Spirit, any compassion and mercy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, with the same love, united in heart, thinking one thing. Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vain glory. Rather, humbly, regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also for those of others. Have in you the same attitude that is also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Coming in human likeness, he found himself found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Sisters, may the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "What is your opinion? A man had two sons. He came to the first and said, 'Son, go out and work in the vineyard today.' He said in reply, 'I will not.' But afterwards changed his mind and went. The man came to the other son and gave the same order. He said in reply, 'Yes, sir,' but did not go. Which of the two did his father's will?" They answered, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Amen, I say to you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. When John came to you in the way of righteousness, you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. Yet even when you saw that, you did not later change your minds and believe in him." My brothers and sisters, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear family, this morning, all the readings, really can reflect or be summed up in one phrase, one sentence even, "Thy will be done," right? That we know so well. "Your will be done, O Father." That we pray again and again in the Our Father. But saying and doing oftentimes is hard, right? One or the other. It's much easier usually to say "Your will be done, Lord." When push comes to shove and difficult times occur, it's that much harder to unite ourselves to the will of God. Many times we might find ourselves like the prophet Ezekiel in the first reading. He's commenting upon the people of his time when they said, "The Lord's way is not fair." And that also echoes on in our own time. How many times have we said, "Lord, that's not fair"? Or we've heard other people say that. And yet, oftentimes we say it's unfair simply because we don't know the full story or the full picture. We know the Lord has brought a saving message to us all, right? Message of hope in a dark and difficult time. Many times, since we don't see the full picture, we don't understand why things happen to ourselves, to our families, and to our friends. And yet, God willing, one day, seeing the Lord face to face, all things will be revealed. Part of the answer to that question of the mysterious nature of God's will is in St. Paul's letter, the Philippians. And he says here, we should have the same attitude that is in Christ. When we unite ourselves with God, with His church, with His message, there's a feeling of peace that can settle into our hearts and souls. No matter what's going on around us, right, in the world, in our families, in our friends, in our communities, in the neighborhoods we live in, we grasp that sense of peace. Peace surpassing understanding, as the phrase goes. When we unite ourselves to the will of God, that's when we find our peace. And that beautiful letter continues as well, St. Paul, right? There's any encouragement in Christ, any solace and love, participation in the Spirit, compassion, mercy, all these beautiful gifts. Gifts the Lord has given us, gifts of the Holy Spirit in a special way. And Matthew today in the Gospel picks up a story that Jesus encounters the religious leaders, the political leaders of his time, those the elders of the people, those held in respect by so much of society. And he tells a story, but he does so in reference to a question that was posed to him earlier in Matthew's Gospel. The scribes, the Pharisees, the leaders had asked, "By what authority do you do these things, these signs, these wonders?" And Jesus then, of course, many times he never answers the question directly. He proposes another question to them. He turns it around and says about John the Baptist, "Who is John to you?" To paraphrase, "Who is John to you?" And then the leaders are a bit trapped because they said, if we say he's not from God, that John isn't a prophet, then the people will rise up and kill us. If we say he is, though, we're not being true to what they thought as religious leaders. And so they were a bit of a predicament. So they said, "We do not know." Interesting, they do not know. They didn't know the will of God. Jesus says, anyone who does the will of God and comes to know him will be saved, right? We know this. And so today, Jesus says, "What is your opinion?" So he asks all of us, "What is your opinion?" There's a story of a father who has two sons, right? We're all beloved sons and daughters of God. And the father comes to the sons, another vineyard story, working the fields, and says to the first, "Son, go out and work in the vineyard today." So once again, this is a link from last week's story about the vineyard in a different way, and a story in a different way of the prodigal son. These two stories start out the same. It was a father who had two sons. The first son today says, "I won't. I will not." Point blank to his father's face. He doesn't say, "Well, let me think about it," or "not feeling well, may please be excused." Straight up, "I will not go. Imagine how the father felt. But yet, after some thought and prayer, he changed his mind and went. Now the second son, you know, came and he saw the father. The father said to him, go out into the vineyard today. He said, yes, sir, I will go. But then he doesn't go. And Jesus asked the leaders, which of the two did the father's will? And I think we would all agree with their response. It's the first, right? The first disrespected the father, said no, but then after much thought and reflection, realized that that was the father's will and did it. Whereas the other one quickly said, I will do it, but then didn't. Jesus goes on to say, compares the leaders of his time to tax collectors and prostitutes, right? Two very different cases of society, two very different ways of living. And yet, Jesus does that, point blank says to the religious leaders, and to all the leaders, they're entering the kingdom of God before you. Because many times we can sometimes fall into a trap of sitting back and saying, just because I'm a follower of Christ, you know, everything's under control. It's good. I hear the word of God, but do I really do the word of God? And those who are full of sinfulness in their life, yet they still cried out for God, these tax collectors, these prostitutes as well. They knew that they were sinful in God's eyes, and yet there was still hope in their heart that God could save them. The leaders thought that they had everything under control, and automatically they would be saved, and so therefore they didn't have to necessarily be attuned to God's Spirit. For all of us, whether we're leaders in our families, our communities, our neighborhoods, in the church, it's a wake-up call, always. Be very careful when we over-professionalize anything spiritual, right? Of course, we're members of Christ's church, the hierarchy of his family, and yet God calls us. And he calls us again and again to change our minds and to believe in him, right? That's a beautiful gift that again and again we have the opportunity to say yes to God, even in the past, if we've denied him. In the end, if we are faithful to God, God will accept us to himself. And we see again and again the Gospels, thy will be done, right? And the link between all these scripture readings. But I would also propose to you this turning back to God is the word conversion. Literally means to turn back, to turn again. And so we see that turning. So today, what or who are we turning towards? And what are we turning away from? That's a question to ask ourselves in prayer and our meditation time today on the Lord's Day, this day of rest as well. Saying versus doing, right? And there's different stages, of course, too. We can come to, St. Jose Maria Escriva talks about this, stages of coming to know the will of God, right? We can, to paraphrase, we can come to understand what God's will is through prayer, through the teachings of his church. So we can know it, and then we can accept it, right? We can say, okay, this is God's will. Then we have to cooperate with it, right? Then we come to say, Lord, I will work with you in this. I want your will to be my will. Then ultimately, the highest form, of course, is to love your will. Help me to love your will, Lord. Very difficult at times, especially if we don't know the full picture. But speaking of thy will be done, today is World Priesthood Sunday. And so on my other hat, my other role as vocation director, behooves me to talk a little bit about that as well, once again. Today we recognize the precious gift of the priesthood that God bestows upon his church. Not only the priesthood of all the faithful, but in a special and particular way, the priesthood of the ordained. And really there's only one true priest, who is Jesus Christ. And all of us who have been ordained participate in Jesus' priesthood. It's a beautiful gift. We're just instruments in the hands of the Lord. And so just as today the Father calls his sons and his daughters in many ways to reach out to those in need, God continues to call young men to the priesthood. There's many that are being called, but few are hearing that voice. Some, like one of the sons, say, yes, I will go, and then out of fear, back off. Others, in many ways myself, my own vocation story, but hear the word of God, his will. Lord, no. Oh, no, that's not what I wanted to do. I'm not good enough, not holy enough. Lord. And yet, in surrendering to God's will, so many graces come forth. You always have to be careful of saying no to God's will, because God has a sense of humor, and he has his own timing, and all things come to perfection in him. But today, too, on this Priesthood Sunday, three of our seminarians that are studying for the Diocese of Venice. Now we have 16 seminarians, as I mentioned before, ranging age from like 19 to 53. They're studying from many different backgrounds to be a priest, to lay down their lives for you. Dear people of God, dear family, the Diocese of Venice. Three of them today are being received into the ministry of lectors and acolytes at St. Vincent de Paul Regional Seminary over on the East Coast in Boynton Beach. And so I ask you to pray for all our seminarians this day, but we also pray in a special way for all those trying to discern the Lord's call, all young people, whatever vocation it is, right? To the married life, to single life dedicated to God, to religious life as consecrated sisters and brothers, and to the priesthood as well. Someone once proposed to me a very interesting plan, because I think sometimes we have the danger of praying for vocations, but we don't always say from our own families. And just because children and grandchildren may have strayed at times doesn't necessarily mean that they're not called, right? God has a plan. But we also have to ask God to raise up, if possible, from our own family, our own neighborhood, our own parish, especially our own families. Jesus tells us in the gospel, go out and work today. That harvest is ready. And going back to this proposal someone proposed to me, I won't say who, a member of the parish, it was very challenging, but very good. I know we all pray for vocations. But they said, what if the only parishes in the diocese that would remain open are ones that had seminarians and priests coming from that parish? Oh, that would light a little fire under us, right? Now, of course, we're blessed at St. Joseph's, though. We think about more from not recent times necessarily, although I know we have a family of one of the seminarians who comes and worships with us here. But Father Mark Huberger was the son of this parish. And many religious sisters came from our parish in the 50s and 60s as well, and a couple other priests as well. That doesn't mean it doesn't happen now. We have to be courageous to live out our faith as well, to say, yes, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. We have to fight for our faith. We have to fight amidst the struggles within ourselves to do God's will, whatever that might be, but also that his will may be done on earth as it is in heaven. And brothers and sisters, when we say that, when we pray that prayer that Jesus gave us, we don't just pray, Lord, may your will be done in my own personal life. Yes, we do. But we also say, may your Lord be done in our world, in our nation, in our state, in our county, in our local community, here in Bradenton and beyond, in our neighborhoods we live in, and here at the church. We have to live out our faith in public. And so as we know, of course, as we get close to the election, we'll be talking more of praying about the issues, of course, that we support as Catholics, beautiful teachings of our faith. But we also know our Catholic faith is going to be really in the spotlight now because of certain decisions, certain appointments being made. And so we pray for the strength to endure what is to come. Because Jesus Christ has won the victory. He is the conqueror of sin and death on that cross to the resurrection. We have him. We have the Holy Spirit with us. Let us be attentive to God's will. So we might not just say, thy will be done, but also may do it. Lastly, in conclusion, today is also, although it's a Sunday, which goes above this memorial in a special way, today is also the feast or memorial, if you want to call it that, of Our Lady Star of the Sea, Stella Maris in Latin. A beautiful phrase. And I think especially living in Southwest Florida, right, to have the Gulf of Mexico nearby, maybe it's an image we can relate to, that Mary is that star on a storm-tossed sea that reflects the light of the sun, right? Reflects the light of the sun in so many ways, okay, and leads us to Jesus. So we pray especially for our parish family down the road in Longboat, Longboat Key, Star of the Sea. Let's pray for them on their feast day today. Let's pray for all of us. Mary, may lead us to Jesus. We may have the courage to say, thy will be done. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us stand now and profess our faith. I believe one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, in whom all things were made, blessed and made for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, under the Virgin Mary, and became man.
For our sake, he was crucified on the conscious power.
He suffered death and was buried,
and rose again in the day,
in accordance with the Scriptures.
He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
Will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. Believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life for the world to come. United in Christ, let us pray for his will to be done and for a church and world that ever in need of conversion.
For all priests who announce God's holy word and celebrate the sacraments of Christ, that they may be joyful witnesses of the mysteries they celebrate for us, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Grant us your spirit of love and self-discipline so that we may come together working to control and eliminate the coronavirus, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For people experiencing changes in family, employment, residence, or health due to COVID-19, for openness to hear God's call to conversion in life's transitions, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For ourselves, for the grace to recognize that we are both saint and sinner, always in need of conversion, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those watching at home and for all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, including Ed Barron, Alex Wenzel, Ginny Karofsky, Barbara Sirio, Nancy McWilliams, and Dolores Nielsen, for care that shows them God's compassionate face, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the recently deceased, including Mary Shelley, Michael Moscati, Alfredo Zaragoza, and Ed Coletta Jr., for entrance to God's heavenly kingdom, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the silence of our hearts, let us present to God all our needs and intercessions. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for the people of St. Joseph's Church, whom we remember in a special way in this liturgy, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Patient and merciful God, your way is justice and peace for all. Unite our prayers to your grace, for we pray in the name we joyfully confess, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Jesus.
Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, mighty and eternal God, for in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. Rightly gives you praise. Through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. You never cease to gather a people to yourself so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with this Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May you make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, the blessed apostles and glorious martyrs with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant Francis, our Pope, and Frank, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. And your compassionate, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children, scattered throughout the world, to our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom, that we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Christ, our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command, formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer to them now a sign.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter into my room, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Body of Christ, please.
Your love on your
here before we did the experiments for the second home special blessing. We join with all those watching and praying online for the spiritual life of Jesus. Also at the same time, we say, the sacrament most holy, the sacrament of praise and love, every moment of the sacrament most holy, the sacrament of praise and love, every moment of the sacrament most holy, the sacrament of praise.
For those sisters who are spending the ministry today, we want to make sure you feel they have a choice to say how to go, to say the death, to make our best we deserve, to make the body of the Son, to say the
brothers and sisters, as we look at the week ahead, once again today, of course, is World Priesthood Sunday. So I ask you, just in your own prayers as well, not only to pray for increase in vocations, to thank God for the gift of those priests who've journeyed with you in your life. Priests who baptized you, brought you Holy Communion for the first time, first confession, anointing, if that was possible, happened in your life, even confirmation, or the bishop who confirmed you as well. Pray for all those priests who have made a difference in our life. Pray for all those who are suffering or for ill as well. We look at the week ahead. Tomorrow, the 28th, is the feast of St. Wenceslaus, martyr. As we all know from that Christmas carol, it's also the anniversary of my diaconate ordination. And then we look at Tuesday, the great feast of the archangels, Michael, Gabriel, Raphael. So if you have any of those names in your family or your own, it's a special feast day for you. Then Wednesday, the 30th, we have St. Jerome, priest, doctor of the church, famous translator of sacred scripture. And then another doctor of the church on Thursday, the little flower, St. Teresa, Therese of the Child Jesus, virgin and doctor of the church. And then on Friday, the feast of the guardian angels. All of us we know are given a guardian angel to watch over us, to rule and guide. We pray for their intercession. And lastly, on Saturday, remember Our Lady again as we look to next Sunday as well, which is the traditional feast of St. Francis of Assisi. So every day of this week, there's a special celebration going on. So I encourage all those who are able to come to daily Mass to unite ourselves with prayer if you are unable to as well, and to continue to pray for one another in the weeks and months and years ahead. Amen. Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, to whose sufferings we are united whenever we proclaim his death, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with
your spirit. God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, before we go, let us raise our hands in thanksgiving and blessing for Father Sean as the, as you was.
As a priest?
Yeah, that's good. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather here this day, on this very special day, we bless Father Sean and Father Rafa, because we are on vacation right now, that they may continue to lead us to the heavenly kingdom. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
May God bless you, Father God. May the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Deacon. Thank you.
One other thing about the being called, this weekend is the first weekend that the gentlemen and their wives have been called to the diaconate. This is their first formation weekend. They'll be forming every
once a month over the next 4 years to become ordained ministers in the church like I am. So remember them in your prayers. 13 of them.
Yeah. 13 of them. All right. Hey. Thank you.
So I guess we're done. Our little sisters, this celebration is it. Let's go forth out to serve God and to serve each other.
Thanks be to God.
Seen a great Lord.